So I'm going to talk about another program from NOAA, the National Estuary Research Reserve System, and a lot of what Lisa just talked about in terms of what we're trying to accomplish at the research reserves. Lisa talked about it for the sanctuaries we're also trying to do at the reserves as well. So I'm going to focus a little bit more on some of the monitoring that we do, how we're applying it to management issues, and hopefully how that opens up a whole breadth of questions that we would love to have people come in and think about and help us consider. So again, the research reserves is another NOAA program. These are federal-state partnerships, so a little bit different than the sanctuaries program. Each reserve has a different state partner. Our partner is California State Parks, for example, and there's three research reserves in California, each has a different state partner. We were established by the Coastal Zone Management Act, so actually the same legislation that established the Coastal Commission in California. So, but our role is to provide protection of resources for research, and importantly, translate that information to management, education, and interpretation. Again, this broader impact sort of thing. So we have staff who know how to do this stuff. So the information we generate, or the information that researchers, other researchers coming in generate, we can translate that all sorts of different ways. The reserves are sprinkled around the country. Our reserve thinks about the whole Southern California bite. Pretty sure there's a country south of us here. I don't really like it. So we think about down into Mexico as well. Our monitoring is focused on the San Diego County area. I'm going to talk a bit about Penasquito Lagoon and the Tijuana River Estuary right at the border. So this ecosystem monitoring program that we do, I say that we're assessing the vital signs of the system. We're taking the pulse of the estuary. And I completely stole this from the National Park Service, this vital signs language. But I think it's really nice, because that's what we're trying to do, is just be out there, see what's happening. So the reserve works with parks, Fish and Wildlife Service. And I'll also mention that much of this work that we do was started by Dr. Joy Zedler at San Diego State many years ago, and we're continuing it on. So we measure water quality, nutrients, plants, sediment, soil, invertebrates, fish, birds, that sort of thing. A variety of different programs, more or less regularly. We often, when trying to make decisions and understand things, we also draw in information from other monitoring programs. And again, it would be great to have additional research and monitoring to help inform what we do. We use these this monitoring for all sorts of different things to help parameterize and calibrate sea level rise models. At the national level, we're trying to develop an index of marsh resilience, looking at a whole bunch of different monitoring metrics. We're tracking restoration trajectories, looking at species management, such as invaders or non-natives. Okay, so I'm going to talk primarily, some of the examples I'm going to give are about the vegetation plant monitoring first, and how it's addressing an issue in Southern California and beyond. So one of the big issues we're facing in coastal wetlands, and maybe come up, I'm sure most of you folks know this, but it is actually too much water. We're in this drought. We think that there's not enough water going around, but in fact, there's too much water coming into our coastal watersheds. In San Diego, we import over 80% of our water. And this urban drool makes its way downhill when people are watering their lawns and washing their cars, especially during summer months. So here's a USGS gauge data, other monitoring programs. Logs guys see this increase in water rolling downhill in Penasquito's Creek. And what's really dramatic is the increase in the dry weather flow, right? So we're in Mediterranean climates, we really shouldn't have perennial streams, but all this importation of fresh water has basically perennialized what should be ephemeral stream in many of our coastal watersheds, especially as you move further south and down the Tijuana River, where it rains less than up here and where it rains less than Santa Barbara County, for example. So this is a big issue. Well, this has been addressed through monitoring of several different sorts. Keith Greer, who was a student at San Diego State, now works for the San Diego Association. basically found a decrease in marine-associated habitats, so salt marsh, salt pan, and at the same time, this uptick in fresh brackish riparian habitats. And we're carrying on this monitoring and adding more data points to the stuff that keep it. So this shows this type conversion from fresh marsh to fresh marsh from saltwater marsh. Joy established some transects in the early 90s in Penasquito's Lagoon. I was actually in Joy's lab at the time working here, and I've seen these changes in these transects where we basically have lost things like pickleweed, the salt marsh plant, and it's been replaced by cattails. Now, and this is in the freshwater influenced areas. So this is an interesting issue because there's nothing particularly wrong with cattails, right? I like red-winged blackbirds and frogs and all that stuff, but you can put that behind my house 10 miles inland. The only place you can put salt marshes at the coast, and we know we've hammered salt marshes already by filling and all sorts of impacts. So this anthropogenic input of fresh water is a concern. So this is actually being addressed from a management perspective. The Regional Water Quality Control Board has issued a sediment TMDL, total maximum daily load. I don't think you can list a system as impaired for fresh water, but you can list it for sediment, which comes in the water. And in the impairment description, it says that it's not differentiated from freshwater inputs and changes in hydrology. I think it's a really big issue. We have some basic information on what's happening, but there'd be a lot of opportunities to come in and address this more fully and think about all sorts of different potential research topics and help us inform the management that's really just beginning. So another example that I'll give is our water quality monitoring, where we deploy these data loggers in our systems. Each reserve throughout the country, all 28, has to have at least 4 data loggers deployed every 15 minutes, ticking away, doing temperature, salinity, DO, turbidity, pH, and depth. So we have 2 in the Tijuana River and 2 up in San Diego Bay. In Penasquitos, we basically have a parallel program where we have 4 of them now. It's a national program, what we call SWAMP, the system-wide monitoring program. The reason why this works is that we have this centralized office in South Carolina that gets people together, that does trainings every year. I mean, these data loggers, the care and feeding of these things is not easy, especially in systems all over the country, from Puerto Rico to Alaska, the Great Lakes. So it's complicated. These folks help us do the QAQC, they absorb the data, they deliver it, so anyone can go on here and download our data. So these guys are great. This is why the program works. There's dedicated funding and dedicated staff just to dealing with the monitoring. So one of the major issues that is being faced for both of interest sort of ecologically but also management in Central and Southern California is this mouth opening and closure. Many of our estuaries in this region are intermittently open to the sea, and these become complicated areas to manage, especially in urban settings. The Tijuana River, where I am, so this is Tijuana down here, this is in the U.S. on the American side. This basically stays open to tidal flushing. We know that it closed during the 83 to 84 El Niños, those big events. It took about a year to open it, to get the permits to open it. During that time, there are all sorts of impacts. The Clapper Rail, which is now Ridgeways Rail, which is a terrible name. It's really hard to say. I still call them Clapper Rail. Basically, they weren't found anymore, so there are all sorts of impacts. So we were poised this year, trying, saying it's another potentially big El Nino. What might happen? We need to know what's happening in the lagoon and be prepared to open it. And it actually did close. Southern California, the El Nino has kind of been a bust in terms of rain, but the marine environment has been very different. Water levels are quite a bit higher. There's been some really big wave events, and one of those wave events piled a bunch of sand in the mouth here, so this is a shot of this area, and closed this system. So we have data loggers ticking along, and we're like literally every day tracking this. These are telemeters, so this goes through satellite uplink. And you can get this information in real time. You can see water depth here, basically tidal action. So you see something happening. The low tides are starting to get perched, cut off. So sand is building up, that sandbar is building up at the mouth. And you are losing tidal action. Here on the 28, basically, tidal action cuts out altogether, right? So you don't see any more tidal activity. When looking at dissolved oxygen, is like a regular regulatory trigger for mouth opening. And we deal with this every year in Penasquitos. The mouth closes, we look at oxygen, it's time to open it. Tijuana is a little different, but even when the mouth closure is here, oxygen is doing pretty well, right? I mean, 8-ish is saturated, so it's getting super saturated, especially during the day. You know, at night you turn off photosynthesis, oxygen goes down. You don't worry about low oxygen early in the morning, you worry about it late in the afternoon when it should be bouncing up. So oxygen is doing okay here. It's still getting saturated, so we're sitting there. It's like, okay, well, I think we're doing all right. The rains are coming this weekend. Rain events should pop the mouth open. That's the natural process. It piles up water, it forms a breach, and then blows open. So let's just see what happens. Unfortunately, like Thursday, there was a sewage spill, which injected some water, you know, of course, right? And the nutrients. And then Friday, like, well, let's just see what happens. So what happens, though, you can see water level go way up. So there was the rainfall, but unfortunately the berm had built up even more. So it didn't pop open, and it added a bunch of nutrients, and it probably stratified. So we added fresh water, which capped the system, and oxygen just tanked, right? So basically flatline, went anoxic for just a couple days. Monday morning we came in and were like, oh crap, we gotta do something. So we opened it, and it restored flushing pretty quickly. But unfortunately, even those 2 days of anoxia were enough to cause problems. So there were dead sharks all over the place. I think I called some out that went up to the shark lab. That was pleasant. I had to walk along with a bag full of dead sharks on my back. But trying to figure out what's going on with these, there was mollusk kills. And this is a little different than we saw in Penasquitos. Penasquitos can stay closed for a while and not have these problems. So there's something different here, but certainly this injection of nutrients was a problem. Spill. And just to wrap up then, another thing that the data can be used for is to look at long-term trends and things that we've been monitoring for years and years. I've just plotted here pH to try, and the reason we looked at pH is to understand what ocean acidification might do. And this clearly shows the seasonal cycles, but basically day-night, that these estuarine organisms experience pH changes far greater than it's expected in the open ocean. Century. That doesn't mean ocean acidification won't have an impact, I think, and this is, we're not sure. This would be great to have people think about this, but it does experience show that there's a lot of variability in these systems. And interestingly, we are already seeing ocean acidification. Now, I don't think this is the marine driver. I think this is probably local metabolism, local respiration. Water's a little bit warmer, but we see this significant decline. And so it's an open question, really, what's happening. But that's part of what we try and do with this monitoring, is generate these open questions. Because what we would like to do is to stimulate new research ideas and get folks in and say, well, that's pretty cool. Let's try and figure out what's going on. For these new ideas or whatever, the monitoring can help provide background data. So if you want to come look at sharks and say, well, don't worry about temperature, and we're doing all that. We do nutrients. All this background information is taken care of. So hopefully it can be a research platform. So it is this early warning system and to track long-term changes. So a ton of folks have been involved in the logo farm up here. I'm sure I missed some.